Open up your Bibles to the book of Revelation, and we are going to look at a new thing that one of the angels who was holding one of the seven vials or bowls of wrath was going to show John. And what the angel is showing them is it in chapter 17. And then there's another angel that shows them another aspect of that in chapter 18. Chapter 17 of Revelation. And there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, Wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman, and of the beast that carried her, which hath the seven heads and ten horns. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit, and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is. And here is the mind which hath wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. And there are seven kings, five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition. And the ten horns which thou sawest are ten kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These have one mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. And these shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And they that are with him are called chosen and faithful. And he saith unto me, The waters which thou sawest, where the whore sitteth, are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. And the ten horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh and burn her with fire. For God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will, and to agree, and give their kingdom unto the beast, until the words of God shall be fulfilled. And the woman which thou sawest in this great city, which reigneth over the kings of the earth. Okay, chapter 18. And after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lighted with his glory. And he carried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her double according to her works. In the cup which she hath filled, fill to her double. How much she hath glorified herself and lived deliciously, so much torment and sorrow give her. For she saith in her heart, I sit a queen, and am no widow, and shall see no sorrow. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be burned utterly with fire. For strong is the Lord God who judgeth her. And the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and lived deliciously with her shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, Alas, alas, that great city Babylon, that mighty city, for in one hour is thy judgment come. And the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, for no man buyeth their merchandise any more. And the merchandise of gold and silver and precious stones and of pearls and fine linen and purple and silk and scarlet and fine wood and all manner of vessels of ivory and all manner of vessels of most precious wood and of brass and iron and marble and cinnamon and odors and ointments and frankincense and wine and oil and fine flour and wheat and beasts and sheep and horses and chariots and slaves and souls of men and the fruits that thy soul lusted after are departed from thee, and all things which were dainty and goodly are departed from thee, and thou shalt find them no more at all. The merchants of these things which were made rich by her shall stand afar off for the fear of her torment, weeping and wailing, and saying, Alas, alas, that great city that was clothed in fine linen and purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls. For in one hour so great riches is come to naught, and every shipmaster and all the company in the ships and the sailors and as many as trade by sea stood afar off and cried when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, What city is like unto this great city? And they cast dust on their heads and cried, weeping and wailing, saying, Alas, alas, that great city wherein were made rich all that had ships in the sea by reason of her costliness, for in one hour she is made desolate. Rejoice over her, thou heaven, and ye holy apostles and prophets, for God hath avenged you on her. And a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and cast it into the sea, saying, Thus with violence shall that great city Babylon be thrown down, and shall be found no more at all. And the voice of harpers and musicians and of pipes and trumpeters shall be heard no more at all in thee, and no craftsman of whatsoever craft he be shall be found any more in thee, and the sound of a millstone shall be heard no more at all in thee, and the light of a candle shall shine no more at all in thee, and the voice of the bridegroom and of the bride shall be heard no more at all in thee. For thy merchants of the great men of the earth and for thy sorceries were all nations deceived, and in her was found the blood of prophets and of saints and of all that were slain upon the earth. Dear Father, in Jesus' name we ask you, Lord, that you give us understanding by your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Holy Spirit, Spirit of truth, that you inspired your servant, the Apostle John, to write down these things for us. Holy Spirit, give us wisdom. Holy Spirit, give us the understanding of the truth and bring us to a realization what the truth really is, dear God. Lord, help us see the truth clearly. We ask that you help us, dear God, and bring us to repentance. And any lie that we've believed, things that we don't even think about, things that are just so commonplace, Lord, bring us to repentance in those areas, Lord, so that we can follow the command here, come out of her, come out of Babylon, Lord. Lord, let us be completely out of Babylon, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. I know there was a lot of reading. I read two chapters. There's a lot here, but both chapters are talking about Babylon. The way that Babylon is first introduced is called a whore. That's a prostitute. That's the way Babylon is referred to. Now, a lot of different commentators, they try to break up 17 and 18 between the religious Babylon and the political Babylon. But as soon as you start saying there's a political Babylon, then you start confusing the beast with the woman who's riding the beast. And I don't want you to do that. I mean, just by saying don't confuse the woman with the beast, it's kind of silly. Yeah, well, you know what a girl looks like and you know what a beast looks like. Don't confuse the two. But it's easy to do that because there's so many things that are interrelated. So I want to make sure that from the beginning, I see this as a whole. I don't see this as two separate things, even though there are two angels that are revealing this to John. I don't want you to separate it, because if you separate it, you're going to confuse the beast with the woman. Okay. And there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials and talked with me. Okay? There are seven vials. We talked about that. The seven vials are the finality of God's judgment upon the earth. And each one of these things we read. And it's a horrible thing. It's called a plague. It's a terrible thing that's coming upon the earth. And as it's finally done, it's Armageddon. All of God's enemies are killed. He shows up as victorious over his enemies and over Israel's enemies. And you've got this planet that isn't anything like what we see today. Because the islands fled away and the mountains were made low. I mean, this is a completely different thing. It's a whole different understanding of what the world will look like when Jesus gets done with it. When all the angels have poured out their vials. Well, one of the angels who is doing this gets John's attention and says, let me tell you about a specific judgment of the Lord. A specific judgment. And this specific judgment is against the great whore, the great prostitute, against Babylon. Says, come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. Okay, so we've got a description of who this is, and it's called the great prostitute who sitteth upon many waters. Well, as we were reading, that phrase, sitteth upon many waters, is described. Remember when we read it, what that is? Verse 15, and he saith unto me, the waters which thou sawest where the whore sitteth are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. He's giving us what that means. She is sitting upon many waters. On those many waters are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. We know what this metaphor means. We're given the meaning. We don't have to make up something. We're given the meaning. She is sitting upon them. And then it says in verse 16, and the ten horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore and shall make her desolate. So there's going to be judgment, and the judgment's going to come from however the earth is separated into 10 nations and 10 kings. Those are going to all of a sudden hate the whore and turn on her. That's given to us. And then verse 18, and the woman which thou sawest in that great city, which reigneth over the kings of the earth. The woman which thou sawest is that great city, which reigneth over the kings of the earth. And then chapter 18 is talking more about the city. So verse 18 is kind of a intro to chapter 18. So she is a city. She is a prostitute. She is sitting upon the peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. Okay, what else does it say about her? And it says, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. Okay, what does a prostitute do? She sells her body for money. So that men can, with money, be immoral with this woman who is willing to take their money. So she is there always in the state of advertising. She's always advertising her beauty, her seductiveness. She's always got yes on her face to whatever man will walk by. She's always got herself in some... She's dressed in a way to draw attention to the sexual aspects of her body, which will, because of the way a man has been created, he's a visual person, he's going to be attracted. He can't help it. That's the way God invented him. Unfortunately, he's only supposed to be looking at his wife and nobody else. Now, Job, righteous, godly man, said, I've made a covenant with my eyes not to even look at a virgin, not to look at a young woman who is in her perfect form. I'm not even going to do it. And then he goes on to say, because she's not my wife, that's my paraphrase. Says that's not mine. That's not the one God gave me. I'm only going to look at the one God gave me and nobody else. I'm not allowed, as a husband, to look at any other woman's body except for my wife. Because that's the one God gave me. And God tells us in the book of Hebrews that marriage is undefiled. The bed is undefiled. God made sex for a man and a woman. One man, one woman for eternity. Before sin, you know. But one man, one woman for a lifetime. Because sin entered the world, now there's death. That's the way it's supposed to be. And then the Bible also tells us reasons why a man and a woman would be separated. Not that you have to, because there's always mercy. There's always forgiveness. And it's not a lot. The biggie is death. That's what separates them. Death. There's the leaving of the unbeliever. And there's also when someone has broken the covenant by having sex with someone else. Those are the reasons. There's not a lot of reasons. It's not like irreconcilable differences or any of these other things, these crazy stuff. Oh, we're just not in love with anymore. I mean, all this stupid stuff that this world has come up with. Because, why? Because there is a great prostitute who is sitting upon peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. And she has been doing what? She has been committing fornication with the inhabitants of the earth, having the inhabitants of the earth being drunk with the wine of her fornication. Now, that's just sexual immorality, sex outside of marriage. But it is also the picture of not being faithful to the one true God. Because through the Old Testament, Israel is the bride of Yahweh, Jehovah God. And whenever Israel would go and worship false gods, she was committing fornication. And they had a death penalty for people who would do that. I mean, if somebody would say, hey, look at these great signs and wonders, and then they would take you to some false god. Or if someone was doing things which we would call the occult, some kind of witchcraft, they'd just take your attention off of the one true God onto some other power, those people, according to the law of Moses, were to be executed. Because God had a wife, it was Israel. And to bring his people away from him into somebody else, is punishable by death. Why? Because all those people who leave the Lord and follow somebody else are going to go to hell for an eternity. And he redeemed them. They belong to him. They're his property. He was jealous for them with a godly jealousy. As every husband is jealous for their wife with a godly jealousy. I mean, there's been times when my wife bought something she thought was really cute. And I told her, I really don't want you wearing that. Because the slit was in the wrong place, it was a little too high, it was a little bit too form-fitting, and I didn't want anybody else looking at her that way. Because she's mine, she doesn't belong to anybody else but me. That is a godly jealousy, the same way our God has a godly jealousy for us. But when you look at what Jesus Christ did, what was the bride price? It was his own lifeblood. That was the bride price. He died for us. He suffered and died for us. And I am commanded as a husband in Ephesians chapter 5 to love my wife as Christ loved the church. So whenever I have some expectation that she doesn't meet, whenever there is some kind of sin in her life, something that's really bothering me, Jesus says, love her like I love you. Does Jesus focus his attention on some weakness of mine, on some sin that I do, and just obsess over it and choose not to like me because of it? No, he died on the cross for it. That's the kind of love I'm supposed to have for my wife. And every husband who's not willing to do that doesn't know that he's going to be held accountable to a holy God for not doing so, because that's his command. But as the man who is set before Jesus in right there in the synagogue, because they knew that Jesus was going to heal, because he's a merciful man, he's going to heal on the Sabbath day. And he had him right there, and he had a withered hand. And he said, come forward. And Jesus said, stretch out your hand. Did that withered, the man with the withered hand, have the ability to stretch out his hand? It was withered. It was the same word that we talked about before. Dried up. There's nothing there. No life there. And he stretched it out. How did he stretch it out? At the command of Jesus. When we love our wives as Christ loved the church, we are stretching out a dried up limb. We can't do it. It's humanly impossible to agape love. But Jesus does it through us. And how is he going to love our wives? Through us. With God's help. Without God's help, I can't do it. I'm incapable of loving my wife as Christ loved the church, because I'm only a human being. But with his help, I can. But if I don't do it, it doesn't happen. It's my job to let Jesus' love flow through me. And if I don't do it, he doesn't do it. And if she doesn't get loved, what happens? Well, she can't trust me, she can't trust God. How is she going to submit to me if she can't trust that Jesus' love is going to flow through me? Well, I can't love her like Jesus does. Of course not. I'm a human being. Jesus is going to do it through me. He commands me to do it, and the moment I step out in obedience, he does it. That's how it works. That's how marriage works. And a woman is commanded to submit to her husband, as the church submits to Christ. Can she do that? Of course not. It's a sinner. Who would want to submit to a sinner? He's a jerk. What idiot would submit to somebody like that? It's not humanly possible. But when she does that, the man is everything that God created him to be. When she doesn't do that, he's not all there. He doesn't have all the parts that he needs to just live another day, to do what he needs to do, to fulfill the call that God has put on his life. If one man just loves as Jesus loves and a woman never submits, you have got a marriage for a lifetime. If a woman only submits and a man never loves her, you've got a marriage that lasts for a lifetime. If you've got a man who loves like Jesus loves and a woman who submits as a Christ, as a church submits to Christ, you have an overflow, and it's called public ministry. And public ministry does not happen unless the man is loving and the woman is submitting by the power of the Holy Spirit. But that's public ministry. And there's too much, and it overflows, and people all over the place get blessed. That's God's plan. And that's what God wants to show. Now, why am I saying all this? Because this is the picture that God has given us from the beginning of time of his relationship with us. That's what he pictures. We have an everyday similitude of our relationship with God, with the church's relationship with Jesus Christ. But we got a problem. There's a whore. There's a prostitute in the way. There's something getting in the way of my wife seeing Jesus in me, from me seeing Jesus in her. It's the prostitute. There's a prostitute in the way. It's the great whore. He carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls and having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Okay, carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness. What's a wilderness? It's a place where there isn't much. Can you survive in the wilderness? Maybe one person can, but it'd be very difficult for two because you got to go long distances every single day to eke out a survival, finding water, finding moisture, finding food. There's not much there. There's nothing happening. There's hardly anything around. That's where she is. A lot of people now in the Christian church are being told how to get there. All you got to do is say Jesus' name 200 times, and your brain shuts off and you get there. Or you can say it's a lecto divina. It's a sacred word. Some little phrase comes right out of the liturgy. Just say it over and over and over again for about 20 minutes and you get there. It's a wilderness. There's nothing there. And what are you going to do when there's nothing there? Just listen in the silence to listen to something, to see what's going to talk to you. And without discernment, you're going to say, oh, God is talking to me. Oh, God is sending an angel to give me information. She's in the wilderness. She's always been in the wilderness. And she's influencing people from there. But she is where? She's sitteth on many waters. She's everywhere. What does it say there? It says, peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. Is there a place where she isn't? Nope. And she's making them drunk with the wine of her fornication. We're talking addicted. People are getting addicted. Well, wine is basically something sweet, but it's got alcohol in it. Now, I don't like it. Personally, it gives me a headache and it tastes really heavy. I mean, maybe there is some kind of wine that I would probably like, but I'm not willing to go around and taste enough to finally get it. But there are sweet wines and there is dry wines. And people can really quickly get to like this. And some people are super tasters, so they don't like the dry wines, but they really like the sweet wines. Other people don't have such a strong sense of taste, so they go for the dry wines. What happens? They get addicted. It tastes good, but it comes with alcohol. So all of a sudden, all you got to do is smell it. Now, talk to any alcoholic. All you got to do is smell the alcohol in the air. And they want a drink. All they got to do is smell it on somebody's breath. And they're willing to buy a beer for them or go buy a mixed drink for them in a bar someplace because, hey, you know, we just need to, you know, relax. Well, that's how alcohol works. That's how alcoholism works. There are lots of folks who are getting addicted to pornography. The word porn, is the same word that's in this word, prostitute or whore. It's any kind of immoral sexual pleasure, basically. There is the bed is undefiled. There is sex between a man and a woman in the lifelong marriage. There's no sin there. God invented that. He wanted that so that kids are born. So that two people will have the good feelings in their mind for that other person. But your brain makes its own drugs. Same way that you drink, it affects your brain and you want to drink some more and feel gooder. Well, the same thing happens. Well, if it's not your wife, it's a dirty picture. You can be just as addicted. Because you're going to feel those same happy feelings in your brain and be addicted to it. It's connected the same way. Either drugs from the outside. If all these people who get addicted to drugs, it's drugs that's changing your brain. And it's stuff from the outside. Sexual addictions is the same, only it's the drugs that your own body makes. Well, she's got all these folks addicted. And they continue to want her. Now, there are, because I did singles ministries, I know from men who I've counseled that they had an affair with somebody or an almost affair with somebody, and now they can't, they can't even see that other person without all of a sudden all the stuff already turning on in their brain is, oh, that's your wife. And they all they can think of is they want to have that person. But the relationship never happened. But every time they see him, all of a sudden all the chemicals start kicking back in again. Because God didn't create us to have dating and serial dating and continuing to date people. That's not what God created. One man, one woman for a lifetime. Because the moment that you have a date, what happens? You get one man, one woman, and they're going to do what God has created, one man, one woman. They start becoming one. And you break off that relationship, and what happens? All of a sudden, you got a sucking chest wound. Both people. Because you started becoming one. And that's not even with sex involved. But if there's sex involved, you've become one. And now to break that off, it is a soul tie. And it's something that goes beyond just a sucking chest wound. It's very difficult to break these things. Because that God wanted one man, one woman for a lifetime. That's His plan. He didn't want all the problems that this world's got. But we've got it. Why? Because we've got this thing, the great whore. And it's wrecking everybody's life because all these people are now getting addicted to the great whore, the great prostitute, in some way. It has a lot to do with religion because it's a substitute for a real relationship with Jesus Christ. As a prostitute is a bad substitute for a real relationship for a man and a wife, so is religion that is not a real relationship with Jesus Christ. It is a bad substitute. It's a substitute, though. And people get addicted to that substitute. Some people get addicted to a substitute religion because that's the closest thing they've got to anything spiritual happening. And you know, there's good feelings. You can go to any kind of church, of any kind of religion, and I guarantee you will have an emotional experience. It's a soulish experience. Is it a spiritual experience? Only if it's the one true God, and that's the Holy Spirit touching your heart and you're falling in love with Jesus Christ. So, as much as I'm talking about sexual perversion and sexual, you know, sexual immorality, it's also talking about religious immorality, so to speak. Well, I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast. Oh, we saw a scarlet-colored beast, a red beast. Didn't we see that before? Full of names of blasphemy. Didn't we hear that before? Having seven heads and 10 horns. We've seen this guy before. It's the devil, but who else? It's the Antichrist. Antichrist looks a whole lot like the devil. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Look at the way this woman was dressed. I mean, she was just a knockout. Purple and scarlet and gold and precious stones and pearls. Now, I can look around and see how anybody, you know, what kind of, you know, has anybody got some jewelry going on? Is it a sin to have jewelry? Let me get some. Oh, here, I forgot. In 1 Timothy, go back a little bit and look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. Starting with verse 9, let's see. Oops. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 9, in like manner also, that women adore themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broided hair or gold or pearls or costly array, but which becoming woman professing godliness with good works. Here's what a godly woman is going to look like. Here's another one too. You can look at 1 Peter chapter 3. Starting in verse 3. Whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaited the hair, of wearing of gold, of putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart, in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. For in this manner of old the holy women also who trusted God adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands. I wanted to bring these out because this is a contrast between a godly woman and a prostitute. A godly woman doesn't have to dress up plainly and unattractively, but where is her adornment? It's from the inside out. It's not from the outside in. It's from the inside out. The adornment is not to attract every man's attention to her and to her body, but it's from the inside out. It's a quiet spirit. Now, I'm not saying it's a sin to curl your hair, but if you do that to attract men's attention to you, remember this one advertisement, be the girl with the hair. I don't know if you remember that. Be the girl with the hair. And I remember that commercial. And, nobody's looking at her hair, on the commercial, because that's not, who cares about her hair? Look at the way she's dressed. She's got the skin-tight clothes going on and all that. I don't even know what her hair looked like anymore. Remember that stupid jingle, though. Doesn't make any difference. Your hair is going to draw attention to you. And what about jewels? What about, you put an earring on your ear, and you're going to draw eyes directly to the nape of the neck, and the shape of your chin, and the softness of your neck. And I mean, all you wear jewelry, and it's going to bring attention to your chest. I mean, this is what a prostitute does. Are you wearing jewelry to draw attention to your body? Or are you going to live a godly life and want God to take favor in you? How are you dressing? Well, that's the difference. Godly women, we've got a couple examples. These were just two that I read. But this is what godly women look like from the outside. It's not about getting their identity by all the men who are this. But that's what this culture is telling you to do. This culture is telling every woman to dress like a prostitute, and that your attractiveness is based on your sexual attractiveness. I mean, we just went to a picnic yesterday with the kids and having a birthday party. And it's like, don't these women know what they're dressed like? Don't they have a clue? It's like, can't you just cover a little bit more? I mean, and what's covered is so skin tight, there's nothing to, nothing to imagination. Not that you want any imagination, it's just, it's ridiculous. But a man's sinful flesh is going to like to look at that. And so a woman is instantly going to get attention because of the way she presents herself. So I just want to bring that. This is not a godly woman. This is a prostitute, and this is what prostitutes do. They draw attention to themselves. Godly women don't draw attention to themselves. They're dressed in a way to basically become invisible to support their husband. Shamefacedness doesn't mean that they're ashamed of their actions. It means that they aren't trying to be the head of the part, the star. the limelight. Everybody needs to listen to what I have to say, even if I got nothing to say. I just want everybody's attention on me. That's not a godly woman. But that's what a prostitute does. And this culture is telling women to become prostitutes. And it's really hard to buy clothing even for little girls that doesn't dress them up as prostitutes. I mean, this is sick. There should be a really big difference between a little girl and a woman in their clothing. A little girl should not be sexually alluring. That's sick. But prostitutes are usually trained very early. Well, here she is. The beast she's sitting on. She's sitting on a beast. Well, I thought that she was sitting on these people's multitudes, nations, and tongues. Yeah. She's also sitting on a beast. She's sitting on waters and she's sitting on a beast. Well, I just want to talk about that a little bit. You ever ride a horse? Yeah? Okay. You're sitting on a horse. Who is more powerful, you or the horse? The horse. But you're riding the horse. And as you get better at riding the horse, you are able to control its movements. You are able to train this horse and keep it under your control. And you're going to use all the power of that horse for your own purposes, for your own pleasure, or for whatever it is. I mean, you might be riding a horse to pull, you know, something to plow a field or to pull a wagon or something, but whatever reason that you're riding that horse, you know it's more powerful than you are, but you are in control. That's what she's doing. She is sitting on something far more powerful than she is. And as we read, we're going to find out that that thing turns on her and destroys her in a day. But right now, she is riding on it. She is controlling its movements, even though it's far more powerful than she is. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. She's holding a cup in her hand, filled with abominations. Interesting. If you're holding a cup, that means that you have something for others to drink or for yourself to drink. Well, it says she's made the earth drunk with the wine of her fornication. She's made the earth drunk. Now, when you're drunk, are you thinking clearly? No. And when you're drunk, what are you thinking? You're thinking how you can have more pleasure. You're not thinking how you're going to have to work hard. How you're going to have to do things to support your own life or the life of your family. No, you're drunk, and all you want to do is think about something else that you're going to like to do. That's what she's holding. She's holding something that she's drunk with, and she's going to make others drunk with. Well, what she's holding is a golden cup, and it's full of abominations and filthiness over fornication. An abomination is something that God hates. It's something that isn't just something that turns people away from the one true God. It is something that brings people into face-to-face rebellion against a holy God. And that's what's in that cup. And filthiness of a fornication. All the uncleanness, all the unholiness, all the unrighteousness of her own fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon, the great mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. On her forehead was written. Well, I know we've talked about things on the forehead or on the hand. You know, all the 144,000 have the Father's name on their forehead. And you got the mark of the beast, yeah? Well, this is something else. Now, in the old days, prostitutes would have some kind of, you know, we would call it a bandana or a sweatband or whatever, or even a hat of some kind. Well, they would have something on there to basically advertise, "Hi, I'm for sale." Well, that's what's on her head, and she is for sale. And it's Mystery Babylon. Now, we talked about that word mystery before. Mystery is not like some kind of Agatha Christie or whoever, you know. It's not that kind of thing. A mystery is something that has been unknown, but it's always something that is known, but now is revealed. Mystery means something that used to be secret, but now we know. That's the idea of mystery. It's not like God's trying to keep a secret from us. He did keep that secret, but now it's known. Now it's revealed. So, Mystery Babylon, the great mother of harlots. Okay, Mystery Babylon. And it says, the great mother of harlots. Or it is Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots. Well, we're finding out something else about her. She's the mother of harlots. She's the mother of prostitutes. Which means what? If there's ever anybody out there willing to use their body to get what they want in life, she is the daughter of the great prostitute. This is where she learned it. This is who bore her. Now, does it mean that you're destined to hell from the time you're born? No. It means that this is people who are continuing in this unrepentantly. This is their real source. This is their real origin. This is where they get their energy and their seductiveness. This is where they are empowered to do that. It comes from her. She is the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. She is the mother of abominations. Everything that is an abomination in the sight of the Lord, she's the mother of it. This is where it comes from. Here's your mom. This is where it comes from. When anyone is tempted to do anything that's an abomination before the Lord, here is your mother. Now, as human beings, we have been created in the image of God. And because of the sin of Adam, we're born in sin. And we're sinners, not just because we sin, even though every single one of us does, but because we were born a sinner. Because we're born as sinners, we sin. And there is no temptation that happens to us that isn't common to all people. That's what the Bible says. It's a temptation, though. The moment we engage in this, we see who our mother really is. That's who's leading us, that's who's guiding us, that's who's inspiring us. She's the mother of abominations of the earth. But I jumped over one little word. Mystery Babylon. Now as we read, and she was called that great city, remember? Now, we didn't read that until the end of 18. But she's called a city. She's a city. She's a prostitute. She's a mother. She's a city. Now, Babylon, where'd that come from? Okay, well, we understand there's a Babylonian captivity. Children of Israel were taken captive by Nebuchadnezzar. We understand that. There's that Babylon. Babylon is mentioned in 1 Peter. It says, those in Babylon salute you. Well, where is Peter writing from? He could be writing from Babylon. Have you ever heard of something called the Babylonian Talmud? It's basically a collection of rabbinical commentaries on what we call the Old Testament. And it was written basically around 500 AD. So a lot of the commentary is against Jesus Christ as Messiah, obviously, because they're not, most of it is not from believers, but they're looking at God's Word, even though they don't accept Jesus as their Messiah. But at that point, the city, the actual city of Babylon, had a lot of Jews in it. 500 years after that, like 1000 AD, there was one of the historians said there were 20,000 Jews in Babylon, or 200,000, I can't remember now. But there was a lot of Jews still there in 1000 AD. Now, there's lots of prophecies against Babylon, because that Babylon is going to be used by God to punish his people. Because Judah, the southern tribes, they went into apostasy. The king Manasseh did the worst that any king had ever done. And he says, because of that, and leading his people into apostasy, judgment is going to happen. There's nothing anybody's going to do about it because of that. Now Manasseh, he got taken captive, and he repented, and he came back. He got saved. He repented. He went into, he was backslidden. He went into as much sin as he could think of, and he got saved there. Well, it was life and death, and you know, he started taking things seriously, and he turned back to the Lord. But God, just because he repented, God still fulfilled his word, and the judgment came, and Judah was taken into Babylonian captivity. Well, Manasseh was doing what? He was doing everything that all the people groups who lived in Canaan to begin with were into. Every ugly, nasty thing you could think of, he was into. And he brought it all into the whole land of Judah. Now, the land of Israel had been apostate from the get-go. And they were taken into Assyrian captivity and scattered all over the place and intermingled with the other nations. So it's hard to know if there's anybody left from that first dispersion of the 10 upper tribes. But they went into Assyrian captivity. Now the southern tribes went into Babylonian captivity, and they were there, and they kept themselves pure in their own tribe, and they returned back to the land little by little, and we read that in Ezra, Nehemiah, and there's Haggai and Zechariah, and there's other books that talk about the return and God speaking to them through all that. It took 70 years before that could happen. Well, we understand that as Babylon. That was that city that they were taken to. But where did that all come from? Now, when I talked about the beast, I said it makes the most sense when we're talking about the beast and the heads of the beast that they are world empires. Remember, we talked about the world empires. And the first one was Egypt. Then came Assyria. Then came Babylon. Then came the Medes and Persians. Then came Greece. Then came Rome. There has not been a world empire since Rome. And as we're talking about this beast and the other things that are kind of confusing that we'll be going through, talking about the head who wasn't, now is, and then the one who isn't has now become the eighth. Well, that's kind of confusing. But we're talking about world empires. And world empires, one of them died. That head is still dead. Rome is still dead, believe it or not. That head is dead. The Roman Empire died. Died, you know, probably in the 4th century, but in definitely in the 5th century. It was already dead by the time the Visigoths came and destroyed it in 476 BC. I mean, AD. It was definitely dead at that point. Because at that point, it went from being Rome to the Holy Roman Empire, when basically the Bishop of Rome took over. And he began to rule in a political way. The Christianity, the Christendom, what we could call Christendom. But Rome is dead. It's been dead. But it's going to come back to life. There's going to be a new Roman Empire. Okay. Well, we were talking about that. And she, the great whore, is riding on the heads of these world empires. And her name is Mystery Babylon. She's been there, riding on the heads of every one of those world empires. She was riding on the head of Egypt, riding on the head of Assyria, riding on the head of Babylon. And she's Mystery Babylon, but she was also riding on the head of Medo-Persians, and the Greeks, and the Romans. So where does Babylon come from? She's been there the whole time. I want you to separate the woman from the beast. It's very easy to confuse it. Once we get into chapter 18, it can be very confusing. We can confuse the two as we think about it, but I wanted to look at it as a whole. She's been riding the whole time. She isn't the beast, but she's been riding the beast the whole time. Okay, where did Babylon come from? Well, open up to Genesis chapter 10. I'm going to look at the beginning, from the beginning of all this stuff. Genesis is the book of beginnings, and we get to see, you know, the world that God created, the world that went into sin, the world that was destroyed by a worldwide flood, and then God saved 8 people. Noah, his wife, and his 3 sons and their wives in the ark. And then God had them reproduce and start repopulating this planet all over again. The ark landed in Ararat. Okay? So, that's Turkey. Modern-day Turkey. And so, the world started becoming repopulated from that point. Okay, chapter 10, starting... Well, I'll just start with verse 1. Now, these are the generations of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Okay, there's the 3 sons. And unto them were sons born after the flood, the sons of Japheth, Gomer and Magog, and Mei and Javan and Tubal and Meshech and Tiras, and the sons of Gomer, Ashkenaz, Riphath, and Togarma, the sons of Javan, Elisha and Tarshish, Kittim and Dodanim. These were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands, every one after his tongue, after their families and their nations. The sons of Ham, verse 6, Cush and Mizraim and Put and Canaan, the sons of Cush, Seba, Havilah, Sabta and Rama and Sabtika, and the sons of Raama, Sheba and Dedan. And Cush begat Nimrod. He became a mighty one in the earth, and he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord. And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel, and Erech, and Akkad, and Calna, in the land of Shinar. Out of that land went forth Asher, and builded Nineveh, and the city Rehoboth, and Kala, and reasoned between Nineveh and Kala, the same as a great city. And Mitzrayim begat Ludim, and Anamim, and Lehabim, and Naphtuhim, and Pathrusim, and Kasuhim, of whom came Philistim, and Kapharim. Okay, we can go on, but there's just a whole lot more words that I have trouble saying. But the main thing is, we saw some names in there that we recognized. This word Mitzrayim is the Hebrew word for Egypt. So some of the translations say Egypt. But some of these other words that you see in here are the names that you're going to read in Psalm 83 and in Ezekiel 38, 39. Same kind of words you're going to read in the book of Revelation. When they're talking about a chunk of property that's going to be used to come against Israel, they're going to go back to the founder, the name of the founder of that city. Why? Because, you know, every single city changed its name from one conqueror to the next. 100 years later, they'll change the name again. And 100 years later, they'll change the name again. I mean, we're in Phoenix, but that doesn't mean it was always called Phoenix. I mean, whatever, you know, the Native Americans who were here, which aren't Native Americans, they came from someplace else. They conquered and took over whatever somebody else was here at. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I mean, things don't change. So what does the Bible do when they go back? Go back to the guy who was originally there. Then we know what that piece of property is, and the people who are living there are going to do what I'm telling you they're going to do. Because God knows the end from the beginning. So these are these names. So you're going to see these names like Magog and and Gomer and Tarshish and Cush and Put. And anyway, so, and the sons of Ham, Cush and Mitzrayim and Put and Canaan, the sons of Cush, Seba, Havilah. Okay, then we get to Cush begat Nimrod, and he began to be a mighty one in the earth. Okay, a mighty one in the earth. Which means he stands up above and beyond all the other humans. He's a mighty one. And he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Well, it sounds like, okay, well, this is a fertile crescent where they're settling. This is around the area, and as we see these other sites that are going to be set here, this is what we know now as Iraq and Iran, Saudi Arabia, I mean, all these little words, it's all that area is what they're talking about. This is the Euphrates River. Tigris and Euphrates River. What happened near the Tigris and Euphrates River? Garden of Eden. It was such an amazing spot on the planet that God built a garden there and had people live there. Here's a blueprint for the world, Adam. Do it. Start here and continue what I started. And put this world under your subjection to my glory. Well, it didn't work that way when sin entered the world. It got a little bit more difficult at that point. But here, he's a mighty hunter before the Lord, Nimrod. He's a mighty one in the earth. That's the grandson of Ham, through Cush. Well, you could say, okay, here is the Fertile Crescent. There are obviously lots of plant life. There's going to be all kinds of wild animals. So, you know, he's a mighty hunter. So he's probably getting rid of all the bad animals so that people could thrive in this area. Well, that's what it kind of sounds like. Mighty hunter. Getting food for his family. Except the word for before the Lord also means against the Lord. He's a mighty hunter against the Lord. Wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter, before the Lord or against the Lord. He is a mighty one in the earth, and he's against the Lord. His name means, Nimrod's name means, let us revolt. I'm a rebel. He's a rebel. And he's a mighty one, which means he is in charge of a whole group of folks who are also in rebellion against the one true God. He's a mighty hunter against the Lord. He is taking captive people and bringing them in rebellion against the Lord. And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel. There's that word, Babel. Well, one way you could translate it is the gate of God. But every other place, when we get in chapter 11, it basically means confusion. And it's interpreted to us to mean confusion. Well, ever see somebody who basically is in charge of a lot of people? And all these people follow that one they just have this presence. And this presence, it just mesmerizes folks. Well, when you're mesmerized, you have to be told what to do because you have lost your sense of direction. And when someone is demonically inspired, people will follow them. And they won't have any discernment. They don't even know what direction they're driving in anymore because they are mesmerized by the person who they've come under their authority completely. It's confusion. And you can tell folks who... Here's a gross generalization. But I'm going to say many of the Mormons I've met, you can feel a sense of confusion around them. You can feel it. And they got this look on their face like, huh, I got a year's supply of food and I'm okay. No, this is a gross generalization, I understand it. But for the most part, there's a confusion. Why? Because they are under the authority of a demonically inspired system. And you can see that. Why do people go to movies? Oh, because there's great acting. Now, who are the greatest actors? The ones who cause the most mesmerization. The mesmerizing of people. The greatest actors are the ones who are demonically inspired. And you can't help but it's like, wow, they just have this presence about them. Ever, you know, they make movies in a place called Hollywood, right? What's Hollywood? Well, it'd be the wood of a holly, right? The wood of holly? Well, where did that come from? Witches have a magic wand. Well, the wand is cut from a holly branch. The holly is this green leaf that stays evergreen in the wintertime, and it has red berries. And so during Christmas time, we have holly. Isn't it so pretty? We think of green being something that stays alive in the winter, so it's everlasting, and red, that must mean the blood of Jesus. Is that where it comes from? The red stands for the blood of the menstrual cycle. And witches, it's part of a religious prostitution, where the men would have sex with a temple prostitute, and they would be absolved from their sins the moment that she would have her menstrual cycle. It's pretty sick. But Hollywood is the stick of that witch that mesmerizes people. And people, just look at people watching a movie. They are being told what emotions to have. And they're all excited. They're on their chair on something big. And they sit down and they feel peace. Then they feel happy. Then they feel sad. You can get people to do anything with the music and the acting and everything. Hollywood. That's the reality of it. It's witchcraft. I'm being real here. This is the reality of what we have here. The Christians who were fundamentalists in the 20s when movies came out, they knew what it was, and they stayed away from them. Now finally, the censors showed up in the 30s. But before that, there was all kinds of stuff that looked like porn. I mean, they weren't like having sex in the movies, but they had naked ladies and other stuff. I mean, it was like, this is crazy. We just think, oh no, now is when they have the pornographic movies. No, that was the beginning of it. They always had it. They had it from the beginning. It's always been to give people entertainment. And they are addicted to that entertainment because they are being paid attention to. They're being worshipped. You're getting enjoyment in some way. It's part of the whole prostitution system of our age, of our world system. Okay, well, here is Nimrod. And he founds a city called Babel. And he's got a son. There's Asher. There's the Assyrians. And there's Nineveh. The great city Nineveh. And all this stuff happens in a couple of generations after the flood. Here are the people who are starting these world empires. Mitzrayim. That's the first world empire, Egypt. There's Asher, the second world empire. There is Babel, Babylonian Empire. It all starts right away. Okay, then chapter 11. And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar. We saw that word Shinar back over here. Land of Shinar. Back to Nimrod again. In the land of Shinar, there's a plain. Well, why would you want to put a building on a plain? Because you can see it from a long distance. It's going to stick out. Everybody's going to know. And they dwelt there. And they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. What's slime? Petroleum products. This is like crude oil, only really thick. It's like the asphalt that's out in the street. You know, there was a man who grew up knowing the Bible, and he read this story, and he realized they were getting thick petroleum products out of the ground right here. This is Babylon. That's Iraq. There's petroleum down there. And he went there, and voila, we are still buying the gas today from the Middle East. He read the Bible, that's where it is. It's still there. They got that slime, this thick asphalt, and that's what they used to glue these bricks. It wasn't just sun-baked bricks. They burnt them. This is like ceramic. This is like the bricks that are in the houses today. You know the red brick? It's clay that they've burned to make it really hard and strong. It wasn't like, you know, in Egypt where they were sun-baking these brick, you know, and putting straw on to make them, you know, nice and strong. These were sun-baked bricks, the same kind of thing that we build house with, that we've been building houses with for generations. Okay. So they had brick for stone and slime they had for mortar. And they said, "Go to, let us build a city and a tower whose top may reach unto the heaven. And let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth." Well, lest we be scattered abroad upon the whole face of the earth? Why would they be scattered abroad upon the whole face of the earth? That's what God commanded. He commanded Noah. You know, you're going to reproduce and you're going to spread over this whole planet. That was the plan. That was God's plan. But Nimrod had another plan. He's a rebel. And he wants to gather all rebels around him. And how do you gather other rebels to yourself? You take them as they are, with all of their rebellion and all of their specific rebellions, and you bring them under your authority. Even though they can rebel against you, as long as your power is stronger than they are, you're happy to have their small individual aspects of rebellion to work for you. That's takes a mighty hunter, mighty man to be able to figure that stuff out. That's what we got here. And they built us a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven, and to make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. They didn't want to do what God wanted them to do. This is basically the beginning of what? A one world government. New world order? It's not new. It was there, right there after the flood. It got started immediately as soon as someone didn't want to do what God said. Says, "Hey, we're going to make a name for ourselves." This is humanism. Humanism at its best. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower. So he's not just looking from above and watching them. No, something has to be done. And says, "The city and the tower which the children of men builded." Okay, people built this. Now, why do I say that? Because there are Babylonian chronicles that were unearthed, and there's one from the third dynasty or something of Ur. You know Ur? Heard of Ur? Ur of the Chaldees? Who do we know from there? Abraham came from Ur of the Chaldees. This is downtown pagan central, where Abraham came from. And God took him out of there, called him to himself, and said, "Go to a land I'm going to give you, that I'm going to tell you about." So God took Abraham out of Babylon, basically. And this tower was built by men. But there's an ancient Babylonian document. Basically, it's not Babylonian. There's an empire right around this area. Now, it wasn't a world empire. So it wasn't one of, but it was the earliest known empire, but it wasn't a world-dominating empire. And it's what we would call Sumeria, the Fertile Crescent. And Sumer was a, you know, if you read anything about Egyptian, history, they'll tell you they're the earliest. Sumer was earlier, because they've unearthed stuff that's even earlier. Now we, you know, Saddam Hussein was going crazy about, you know, rebuilding Babylon. He did quite a bit. He had lots of money to do so. And there, he's got, you know, he took over where the German archaeologists 100 years before had found things in there. So he just took over where they left off. But he wanted to have basically a big Babylonian Disneyland going on over there. But there's a thing called Desert Storm that kind of stopped him in his path. But anyway, it would have happened if it wasn't for everybody else getting involved. But there, so they found these things, unearthed them by archaeology, and it says that the gods built this temple. Now, it wasn't the gods. This thing also says that the world had a common language. Well, there's, you know, ancient documents that have been unearthed from archaeology, and there's at least, you know, 60 of them that say that there was a common language at one point. But there was this god, I think his name was Enki, who was a god of wisdom who confused the languages. They have their own version of what really happened. We have the biblical version. We have the Holy Spirit-inspired version. We know what really happened. They have a tradition. And they have got lots of gods who are just arbitrary and capricious like people. Well, the one true God isn't like that. He's a just God. He's a righteous God. So anyway, I just want to say that because they've found extra-biblical material that basically says the same story, only a worldly way. Verse 6, and the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. People are one. The New World Order is working on unity. They have to have unity. Everybody's got to have one mind. This is the way it's got to be. All the humans have to be in 100% agreement. That's what happened here. The Tower of Babel. They were all in agreement. They were unified. I mean, unity is amazingly powerful. You get a whole bunch of people with the same mind, and it's an amazing power and influence, and you can do just about anything. And that's what the Bible says. They have one language, and this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do. Well, what did God say about the imagination of man's heart before the flood? It's evil from their youth. It's only evil all the time. So they're going to come up with something that's totally in rebelling against God to the point where they're going to have world domination and nobody's going to get saved. And God needs to save people, so He has to intercede. He has to break up their unity. Well, this is unity at all costs. They're going to have complete and total unity. Got to be unified in purpose. There's a lot of Christians who are Christian leaders, even in the evangelical community, and this is all they preach. We got to be unified. We got to be unified as a church. And so they make sure they find anybody who's going to be a dissenter. And they take these really large, huge mega churches and they bust them up into little cell groups. And in their little cell groups, they find out who isn't on the program. And then they use peer pressure in that little cell group to bring people to a better understanding and get them online with the program. This isn't anything new. TQM, Total Quality Management, bringing people to a consensus, isn't anything new. This is Babylonian religion. Get everybody unified. It's all about unity. And of course, you'll hear things in the Christian church that say, you know, when the Church of Christ is divided, who bleeds? Now, have you ever heard that? It's all about getting everybody together and having one big, you know, kumbaya to the Lord together, you know, because unity is cutting up the body of Christ. Is that true? Where is the church? Is the church not in unity? The church is completely united under Christ. He is the head. And most of the church is dead right now. They are in heaven with Jesus right now. And the people who are in the church, who are truly members of the Church of Christ, of Jesus Christ, are going to be found in a whole lot of little churches and big churches and denominations and even in some apostate denominations because they're true believers in Jesus Christ. It's not unity from the outside. It's unity from the inside. Tozer said, if you take a tuning fork and you tune 100 pianos with that same tuning fork, all those pianos are automatically in tune with each other because they're in tune with the same tuning fork. We are united. Doesn't matter what denomination anybody is in, the true believers are all united with most of the believers that exist who are all in heaven with Jesus right now. There's not too many of us in comparison to all the believers who are in heaven. We are the minority, the ones who are alive right now. We are the minority. The majority are all those who are with the Lord right now. There's 100% unity. It's not unity on the outside that the people see, but you'll hear rhetoric from strong evangelical leaders that say, the world sees a divided church and that's what's keeping evangelism from happening. We're not united here. If we were united here, we'd be a Babylon. We'd be the Tower of Babel. And there's a lot of churches it's all about, we're going to build our own Babylon. Because there's one senior pastor and it's his program, and if you're not with the program, you're out of here. And they kick you to the curb. And they're kicking out true prophets, they're kicking out true believers all the time because they don't want to be with the program. And it's all about unity. All one mind. We all got to believe the same thing. We all got to do the same thing. We all got to focus on the same united purpose. No, this is Babylon. This isn't the church. It's Babylon. It's not the church. Okay. Nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down and confuse their language that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of the earth, and they left off to build the city. They left. They were building the city, building the temple. They didn't finish it. We're out of here. I mean, you're working with somebody for years, and all of a sudden, and you're going, what? Are you nuts? And you don't even know. You can't work with the guy. He doesn't even think the same way you do. I mean, it's like a word. Every word is different, and it's just like, what is going on? And you talk to somebody else, and they're mad at you because, you know, you're insulting them, and you didn't even know what you said. I mean, there's no way that they could keep this thing going. God busted them up. And so they found everybody else, and you know what? They're of the same family who spoke that same language. As you go through down here, you'll find in verse 14, this is now the descendants of Shem, and Shelah lived 30 years and begat Eber. And Shelah lived after he begat Eber 400 years and three years and begat sons and daughters. And Eber lived 430 years and begat Peleg. And Eber lived after he begat Peleg 430 years and begat sons and daughters. And Peleg lived 30 years and begat Roy. And Peleg lived after he begat Roy 209 years and begat sons. Okay, so here's his name Peleg, which means the dividing. Well, the dividing happened somewhere in Peleg's life. He got named after the dividing. The dividing of the speeches, of the different languages. The dividing of the earth. And they were going to speak his grandfather's language, which is the language of Eber, which is called Hebrew. That's the dividing. They're going to speak their own language, and it came from a grandfather. So that's how God separated everybody. So you're going to be with your own family, but you're going to be separated, and you just can't deal with all these other folks who you don't know, you can't understand them, so we're going to go someplace by ourselves. And God accomplished what he told them to do when they wouldn't do it. But what were they trying to do? They were trying to unify all the humans in rebellion against God. And they had this big, huge Tower of Babel, Tower of Confusion. Is it the gate to God? It wasn't the gate to God. It was the gate away from God. And it became confusion. Well, they've done archaeology, as I said, and they found this. They've found what they think is this place that was used to be the Tower of Babel. And they're looking at it by means of archaeology, and it's called the Temple of Marduk. Marduk. Well, Marduk is actually Nimrod. Same guy, different name. Temple of Marduk. They're worshiping Nimrod. And it's called the Foundation of Heaven and Earth is the name of this, of Foundation of Heaven and Earth is the name of the archaeological site. And they figured it must have been at least 300 feet tall. So here's a plane, and you're going to look at this thing as 300 feet tall. Well, there are some scientists trying to figure out how could they make fired bricks that are mortared together with asphalt, how could they make it that tall? And so he's working out engineering and so on, and he's figuring out you could actually, with those kind of bricks, if you made it in the shape of what we know as a ziggurat, which means the outside walls and they get smaller and smaller and go up, you could actually get it at 2 miles high before the bottom brick would start to break. And the way they've seen it with like a double wall and how big the walls were, they could have kept going. So 300 feet for as much as that's really tall. That would be, what, a 300-story building? I mean a 30-story building. I mean, that would be huge. It could have gone a whole lot taller. But God didn't let him do it. What's interesting is, it is a spiritual stronghold. And world leaders, over the centuries, have tried to rebuild it. I mean, if you look through the history of Babylon, and how many people tried to rebuild the Tower of Babel. And they're not calling it Tower of Babel. They're basically, a lot of them are calling it the Temple of Marduk. And we see some of it being accomplished through Nebuchadnezzar and his dad. They rebuilt this thing. And of course, Nebuchadnezzar says, look at this city and the tower that I built. And of course, at that point, God says, you did this? You're gonna be an animal for the next 7 years and grow long hair like bird's feathers and grow fingernails like claws and eat grass for the next 7 years. And here was Daniel, and Daniel was second in charge, and he basically ran Babylon. I'm sure they would have made quite the profit, because here would be a godly man doing things the right way, and things would have made sure there wasn't any, you know, intrigue or whatever. So when Nebuchadnezzar came back to his senses, he had a thriving Babylon back under his authority. But he knew who the God of heaven and earth was. He knew that God puts up the basis of men as leaders. He knew who God really was. His grandson didn't know it. And he was having some kind of drunken party, and even using the things that were dedicated to the Lord that came from the temple, Solomon's temple. And they were going to drink out of these things, and all of a sudden here comes his hand. It looks like a human hand appear, start writing on the wall. Many, many, tikli, farsin. Of course, they got scared. Now, here's God's hand, he's saying. God can't find out. And then, sure enough, Queen Mother shows up. You know, your grandfather knew about this, and there's a man who knows about it, and bring in Daniel. And of course, he's going, oh, well, I'll give you half of my kingdom, and give you all these robes, give you all these riches. You tell me what this means. Says, you know, God says you've been weighing the balances and found wanting. Your kingdom's getting given over to the Medes and the Persians. You're going to die tonight. And then you lost your kingdom. It's over. Yeah. So, you know, he gave Daniel all this stuff. And so, sure enough, that night, here comes Cyrus. They go through the gates that were basically supposedly locked where the river was going through, and they just diverted the water, walked right in, killed everybody in charge, and took over. Quite interesting. Anyway, the Medes and the Persians, they kept Babylon running. And they kept all the temple, they kept all that stuff. But then Medes and the Persians, after taking over the Babylonian Empire, that gets taken over by the Greek Empire. That's Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great, they're, you know, destroying all these things, but he gets so enthralled in the spiritual power of this place that he's going to rebuild that temple. And so he scrapes it off and he starts rebuilding it. but he dies at 32. He never finishes it. And there's other people who have conquered Babylon and tried to rebuild the temple. And they always scrape it off and try to start all over again. Try to start over again and they get killed. Even Napoleon. He tries to do the same thing. And he didn't end so well either. Now we finally get, in our days, Saddam Hussein. He's doing the same thing. And he didn't last that long either. There's Desert Storm. Now, why am I saying this? The only reason why people are doing this is because of the spiritual stronghold that's behind it. It's a mystery, but it's more than the town. It's more than the city. It is the great prostitute who is riding the heads of every world empire. And it started with Nimrod, who wanted to bring all the world under his authority. Well, Nimrod had a wife. Nimrod's wife's name is Semiramis, or Semiramis. And she had a son. Well, according to tradition, Nimrod died. But Nimrod, his other name is Ninus. He died. But she gave birth to a son, miraculously. And her son's name was Tammuz. Semiramis, we can read about her in the Bible. Even though we don't have the basis of the stories of her life, but we can read about her in the Bible. Jeremiah 44. Jeremiah is a prophet during the time when Judah is going into apostasy. And he's pleading with the people to repent from all of their pagan ways. In Jeremiah 44, well, verse 15, then all the men which knew that their wives had burned incense unto other gods, and all the women that stood by, a great multitude, even all the people that dwelt in the land of Egypt, and Pathros answered Jeremiah, saying, as for the word that thou hast spoken unto us in the name of the Lord, we will not hearken unto thee. But we will certainly do whatsoever thing goeth forth out of our own mouth, to burn incense unto the Queen of Heaven, and to pour out drink offerings unto her, as we have done, we and our fathers and our kings and our princes, and the cities of Judah and the streets of Jerusalem, and for them we have plenty of victuals. What are they saying? We're not going to listen to you telling us that we got to repent and not worship these things. We've done it, our father's done it, our grandfather's done it. This is the land of Judah. These are the people, this is the Jewish leadership, and they are admitting to worshiping and burning incense to the Queen of Heaven, Semiramis. Nimrod's wife, Ninus's wife. Nimrod died. She gave birth to a son. Her son's name is Tammuz. Well, Tammuz was killed by a wild boar, and he came back to life. But Semiramis said, this man is my husband. This isn't my son, this is my husband. This is Ninus back to life. Pretty weird. The son becomes a father? The son is a husband? Doesn't make any sense, does it? Except that, I mean, there's other places in the Bible, in Ezekiel 8:14, Jeremiah 7:18, Jeremiah 51:7-13. We could look through here, and we're going to see the word Tammuz. We're going to see more about the Queen of Heaven. And they make little cakes. And these little cakes have the symbol that stands for Tammuz. Well, Tammuz starts with the letter T. And that's the Greek letter tau. you know what a T looks like. It's a cross. To this day, on Good Friday, people make hot cross buns. These are the cakes with the letter T that stands for Tammuz. And then, Easter Sunday. Easter. Ever heard that name? Easter is the same word as Ishtar, which is another name for Semiramis. Easter is the day that they're going to eat ham because it was a wild boar that killed Tammuz. 40 days before Easter, people are mourning for the death of Tammuz for 40 days. It's called Lent. They're mourning for the death of Tammuz. And during that period of time, they don't eat any meat until Ishtar. And they eat ham on Easter. Because he was mysteriously resurrected. This happened a long, 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 long time ago. Nimrod's wife and his kid turned into a world religion. Now, let me just read a list here. Okay, Semiramis the first high priestess, Babylonian mystery religion, claimed to have a son, Tammuz, born in a miraculous fashion, who is supposed to be the promised deliverer. Yeah, it's going to bring everybody unto, once again, Nimrod's one world system. Promised deliverer. And you know what? This world is still waiting. And they're all getting on board. They're getting on board to have a one world government and to have a person who's going to be in charge of that one world government. Called that we're going to call the Antichrist. They called him Tammuz, the letter T. Well, Diana of the Ephesians. She's called Artemis. Remember? Paul was thrown in prison because, you know, they were, you know, people were turning away from worshiping in all these temples, and they were turning to Jesus Christ. And so all these, you know, the Teamsters were getting angry because they weren't buying their goods. Well, this, you know, Diana of the Ephesians, this is Artemis, and here was this woman. You know, she's got two lions, she's got a son, but she's got a many-breasted one. You know, she has, every one of those has like 100 breasts on her chest. It's just a bizarro-looking idol thing that they were making. But she had a son. Same kind of thing. Bacchus. Bacchus is a god of wine, of enjoyment, of physical, anything that your body wants to do, that's what he was the god of. Okay. The Phoenicians had Ashtoreth and Tammuz. So Ashtoreth is the Asherah poles. Remember Baal? Well, Baal comes from Bel. Bel is another name for Marduk, who's another name for Nimrod, moon god. Same guy. Same false deity. Baal and Ashtoreth. And remember how Ashtoreth worship and Baal worship, and there was Elijah, it's like they, you know, calling down fire, and it ate up them. It ate up the thing that was dedicated to the one true God, Yahweh, Jehovah God. And here is all this stuff going on with all these priests of Baal and all these priests of Ashtoreth doing all these crazy things. This is Babylonian worship to get God's chosen people to take their eyes away from Him and onto something that is the one world government's religion. To unify the world under this one world world religion. Okay. Egypt had Isis and Horus. But Horus is actually Osiris, come back to life. Same deal. Same thing. Same false gods. You got the Greeks. Aphrodite. And her son's name was Eros. Aphrodite, okay? And then in the Italian Roman god, we've got Venus, and her son's name was Cupid. And then in Asia, we talked about this when we were talking about some of the churches in Asia. Remember I was talking about the different temples in some of these cities? There was this one temple for Cybele, and there was these Cybelline prophets, prophetesses, and so on. Well, that's the same. Cybele and Dioius was her son. Same religion. Different connection. Different area. And then in India, you got Issi and Issuara. Issi and Issuara. Same false god. All these different world religions all got the same false god, and it all started with Nimrod. Babylonian religion. The scary part is this all came into Christianity. As Christianity spread, there is the genuine spread of Christianity when a person who's been born again has been changed by the love of Jesus Christ, has given themselves over to following the true faith, and their life has been changed, and they can't help talking about Jesus to the people who they know and love, and their lives are changed, and they turn the world upside down. Why was the world turned upside down? Because the world had already been given over to Babylonian religion. I mean, when I was talking about the seven churches, I was telling you all the different pagan influences in all these churches. Why? This is all connected. That's what the world looks like to people. It still looks like that to people to this day. And Christianity shows up and it turns it upside down. And they were turning the world upside down, which means all these traditions that we've celebrated as a kid. Do you mean, I mean, I don't want to keep my kids from, what just happened the other day. Well, I got candy going door to door when I was a kid. I wouldn't want to keep my kids from having the same amount of fun that I did. Well, we had a Christmas tree and we had presents that we opened up under the Christmas tree. I wouldn't want to keep that. That everybody loves that. And when I look at the Christmas tree, I think of the cross. And it's the light, so Jesus is the light of the world. See, it's all about Christmas. It's all about Jesus being born. Now, Christmas is basically a celebration of Saturn. Because there is a time when they have the shortest day of the year. That's the 21st of December. And then after that, the days start getting a little bit longer. So by the time you get to the 25th, there's a definite change where the sun comes up a little bit earlier and the sun goes down a little bit later. And they're celebrating the fact that we're going to have another year. We're not going to stay into the depths of winter. And they have the celebration on the 25th of December every year. Well, the Catholic Church absorbed from the time where a Roman emperor named Constantine decided to choose Christianity over other religions. And why did he do that? Because it seemed to make more sense, because there was more Christians at this point than there was all these pagans. And the Christians were fighting with the truth, and there were some who were off in one direction, some were off in one other direction, but he wanted to unify all Christianity. And he wanted to do that because he needed the Christians full-hearted serving him to fight against their enemies. And so what did he do? He unified the Christian church. The Council of Nicaea. We have the Nicene Creed. It's a little bit different from the original one. They added a few things later. But this is what it means to be a Christian. See, we all believe the same thing. It's okay. It's called what? An ecumenical creed. We're all going to be one. Christians are all. It doesn't matter if you have some different views. This is what it means. This is the basic stuff. And there was a guy named Augustine who was helping, who helped also unify Christianity. And certain things that were way off base, they had to deal with, where Jesus isn't God, or Jesus isn't man. So they had to deal with things like that. So the crazy Gnosticism that infested North Africa, they had to deal with. Because what happened? There was some battle that needed to be waged, and things weren't going well for Constantine. Then he had this vision, or he saw something in the sky, which was a cross. The sign for Tammuz. But Christians had absorbed the cross as their symbol. You see a cross everywhere, and you just look right away. Jesus died on that cross. Now the Bible doesn't use that word. It uses the word for wood, or the word that can also be translated a large spike. And so the Jehovah's Witnesses will come to your door and say, see, the cross isn't even in the Bible. It was a piece of wood. Except if you look at the other thing, the word crucified means that he was on the cross. But to begin with, this is a torture to death device. It wasn't something that people used as some nice pretty ornament to begin with. For a couple of hundred years of Christianity, people never wore a cross. Because that was the Roman death sentence. I mean, if it's an electric chair for lethal injection, you wouldn't wear around this electric chair around your neck or this hypodermic needle-looking thing. I mean, it would be disgusting. That's how people die. People, horrible, terrible criminals die, and that's the means by which they died. Or a firing squad, or you know, a noose or something, and hang that around your neck. It's like, no, Jesus was executed on a Roman cross. So there's enough extra-biblical information that give us the proof that it was a cross that he died on. But what have we done to the cross? We have turned it into an icon. Icon is very powerful. Because you look at that icon and you project into that icon everything that you personally believe. But somebody else who believes something totally different can look at that same icon and project into it everything that they believe. And so the Roman Catholic Church filled all of their places of worship with icons so that everybody has their own personal understanding of what they think it means. And they will all look at it and basically worship it. Now, I love the cross, but I don't pray to the cross. It is an icon because I know my Savior died on that cross. He paid for my sins on that cross. But that's the same sign for Tammuz, who you're going to mourn for 40 days and not eat any kind of meat, and then on Easter, you're going to eat ham. Same icon, different day. So as the Roman Catholic Church, Catholic means general, means this is what everybody believes. What's that? It means universal. Universal. This is what the. If you're a believer, this is what it is. And it's all about unity. Unity at all costs. Which means you can have all kinds of various ways of thinking about things, different interpretations, completely different concepts whatsoever, but you're all unified. The universal church. Well, a problem happened. There was an argument about when were we going to celebrate Easter. And so the Eastern Church had their own ideas. And the Western Church had their own ideas. So they separated. So now you got the Greek Orthodox Church, that's the Eastern Church, and now you got the Roman Catholic Church, which is the Western Church. And the dividing line is the Euphrates River again. Constantinople, which is Istanbul, that was right in the middle. Now, all of a sudden, you've got way over on the west side in Rome, is where the seat of government is. West and East separated. So now there's conflicts. But if you look in the Greek Orthodox Church, you want to talk about icons? They got so many, you can't even imagine it. And they're all absorptions that are even closer to other world's religions. I remember when I was a kid, I saw this thing, I thought it was neat. It looked like a cross with a little round thing above it. I thought, well, that's neat. Until I found out, oh, this is what Egyptian thing. It looks like a round ball with a cross underneath it. Well, it's Tammuz, and a round ball is the globe of the moon. Who's the moon god? Bel. Who's Bel? Marduk. Nimrod. So, as the woman's menstrual cycle, there is the egg. You got little bunnies. And they got Easter eggs. And they color them different colors. Where does that come from? Babylonian religion. And Christians come up with all kinds of neat stories how to try to Christianize that Easter egg. Oh, but I did as a kid. I wouldn't want my kids to miss out on that. I mean, they're all, you know, it's so fun to hold a little egg in there and to put it in the hot water with a different color and come up. And it's not dark enough. You got to stick it in there and color it up some more. Isn't that fun? And you can put the little wax things and make little words and things. It's Easter. It doesn't celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ from the dead. It celebrates Ishtar, Babylonian religion. Even in the Passover Seder, they got an egg in there. Where did that come from? As we read in the book of Jeremiah, for generations even before the Babylonian captivity, they were already worshiping the Queen of Heaven and making little cakes to Tammuz. That's not gone. Now, why am I saying all this? It's not just the Roman Catholic Church. Oh, they're the bad guys. Oh, those bad Catholics out there. It has nothing to do with Catholicism. It has to do with Mystery Babylon. It is definitely a religious system that takes everybody's mind away from the real thing. Jesus Christ, God who created this world, became a man, died in our place to pay the penalty for our sin, and then rose again 3 days later. Now, he was in the grave 3 nights and 3 days. He says that. And he even uses the book of Jonah. As Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of a fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the earth. Yeah, but I thought Jesus died on Good Friday. How did he get 3 nights and 3 days out of Friday, Saturday, and all of a sudden Sunday morning, he's already out of the grave? Because you've got to morph what really happened that week into Babylonian religion. You've got to squeeze it into something where it doesn't belong. So he's got to die on Good Friday. Because you got to keep the whole Tammuz thing going. So that there he is, and you can have your ham on Easter Sunday. Everybody's got Easter ham. Nobody knows why. You got to eat the animal that killed Tammuz. You got to eat the boar that killed Tammuz. Got to eat the ham. Now, have I wrecked every holiday? Christmas is a celebration of God becoming man and living among us and taking our place, bearing our shame, being punished for our sins, and rising from the dead. But is that what we celebrate? We've got a collection of the remnants of this original Babylonian religion that has gone through several different world religions, several different cultures and variations of those world religions, and we've accumulated traditions upon traditions upon traditions, and added them all together and come up to what we call Christmas. But Christmas, just look at that word. What does that mean? It is the Mass of Christ. Well, what is a Mass? The Mass is when you get a Roman Catholic priest and he takes the bread and he says those words of consecration over that bread, and he turns it into the body of Christ. And then he takes the wine and he says the words of consecration over the wine. If you watch what they do, they make sure they lift the lid up so that those elements actually hear the words of God being spoken over them so that they turn into that. And then there's this other lid that's on top of the chalice, and they scoot it back just enough so that it can hear the words. So that it gets turned into... Did you ever hear the word hocus pocus? Oh yeah, that's a little magic trick. You say hocus pocus. Right? It comes from the Mass. Hoc est corpus. This is my body. Because they see a hocus pocus going on. They see magic going on of the Mass, where this priest is turning these elements into the body and blood of Christ. So that when you take it, you are actually offering up again Jesus on the cross as you eat that bread. And they used to keep the wine away from the people because you wouldn't want to spill the blood of Christ. So only the priest drinks it. Now they've kind of changed that since Vatican II. But this is pure, unadulterated Babylonian religion. We have the juice of the vine, and we have unleavened bread, and we celebrate the new covenant. And we do what the Bible tells us, which says, we do what? We do this in remembrance of Him. We're remembering what Jesus did for us. We're celebrating with these simple things what He did for us. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are what? Proclaiming the Lord's death until He returns. We are taking this and saying, Lord, we're waiting for You because You said before You left, I won't drink of the cup of the vine until I return. I won't do it again until I'll do it with You in my Father's kingdom. We're waiting for Jesus to return whenever we take the Lord's Supper. We're proclaiming the fact that Jesus is coming to take us to be with Him in His Father's home. We are waiting for that to happen. But to take it and say, okay, we have just made Jesus happen. This is called the Eucharist, the Eucharistic Mass. Eucharist comes from words thanks. And that comes from the words of that you say over the elements when you turn them into the body and the blood. Christ, Messiah, and this thing where you're offering Him up again. Well, that's an abomination before the Lord. Christ died once for the sins of mankind. You read it over and over again in the book of Hebrews. Once and for all, once and for all. One time Jesus died. One time He poured out His blood. One time for the sins of the world. It's not up to me to offer Him up again and again and again to somehow get rid of some more of my sins. You know, there's a part of Babylonian religion that we don't really realize. We don't see it in the evangelical community so much. But there was confessing your sins to one of the priests. That's Babylonian religion. Taken right into the Catholic Church. There's also what's known as the College of Cardinals. Come straight out of Babylonian religion. Remember when the Ark of the Covenant was taken by the Philistines, and they put it in the temple of their god, Dagon. Dagon was a fish. Well, the next morning, here he was on his face before the Ark of the Covenant. The next day, Dagon was busted up. That religion got brought right into the Catholic Church, and you see it to this day with the hats. The fish head hat that they wear comes directly out of there. And the Pope is called Pontifex Maximus, the great pontiff. Do you know where that comes from? Babylonian religion. Babylonian religion went from Babylon, and it also had it moved to a city that we read about, the city that has Satan's throne in it. Remember? Pergamos. Satan's throne is there. They had a big temple that was Babylonian religion. And the Etruscans, these are like the precursors to what we know as the Italians. The Etruscans took all of that Babylonian religion and kept it with them. And there's a famous Etruscan that you might know. His name is Julius Caesar. he took upon himself the name Pontifex Maximus. He was the head, not just of the political empire, but of the Babylonian religion. Well, we know of another guy, Luke 2, Caesar Augustus. This happened to be Julius Caesar's nephew. And when he... What had happened during the time of Julius Caesar, they had a republic, which means they had senators. Well, when there was, you know, there was Mark Antony and Cleopatra, they got together, they tried to destroy the forces of a guy named Octavian. Octavian is Caesar Augustus's nephew. Well, Octavian was a whole lot smarter and a whole lot brighter, and he had smaller forces, but he had faster ships, and he destroyed Mark Antony and Cleopatra's forces. And he consolidated all of the Roman Empire. Now, this is where Rome becomes a world empire. And his name is Augustus Caesar. That name Augustus is another name for deity. He proclaimed himself to be God, Augustus Caesar, and had a decree that all men should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria, and all went to be taxed, each one to his own city. You know the rest of the story. Joseph also went, you know. You can continue it. Probably memorize it when you were a kid. Said in front of church. Julius Caesar. Augustus Caesar. He took that same name, Pontifex Maximus. And then every Caesar after him took the name Pontifex Maximus. Until finally, that world empire is fizzling out, rotting from the inside, and finally, Rome is sacked, and pretty much there's no longer any Roman emperor anymore. It's pretty much nothing's left by the Visigoths in 476 AD. But there was a bishop of Rome who basically had a lot more political power in his religious authority than the emperor at the time. And he just kind of absorbed the name Pontifex Maximus. And so now, we have a pope. And the popes, from one pope to the next, all have the name Pontifex Maximus. The Pope is a vicar of Christ. The Pope takes the place of Jesus Christ on this earth. Every single Pope, by the title of his name, is proclaiming himself to be the Antichrist. Is the Pope the Antichrist? No, at best he's a false prophet, but he's not the Antichrist. He is the head. He's a whole lot like the false prophet having two horns. You know, definitely a religious leader. Some political influence there. But he's not. You don't want to confuse the false prophet with the Antichrist, with the beast. You don't want to confuse those two. Now, there's a whole lot of information. I understand it. How is this the least bit edifying? Know what the truth is. Know what Christianity really is. And know what it is not. Now, during different times of church history, there's been different groups who read the Word, believed the Word, followed the Word, and they got rid of all this stuff. Now, in the Reformation, there is this thing, of course, I don't celebrate Easter. I mean, I don't celebrate Easter. I don't celebrate, you know, Halloween. I celebrate the Reformation. As a good Lutheran, get to watch the Luther movie from 1956, the real one, where it was historically accurate. Oh, isn't that great? It's a great movie, by the way. Okay, Luther brought a whole lot of Christianity back to the Word. The Word has got the authority. The Church doesn't have the authority. Not all the traditions of man have the authority. They're not on the same level as Scripture. Scripture is what's important. Now, he did that, but he didn't go far enough, because he kept a whole lot of Babylonian religion. In fact, Martin Luther was the one who decided to cut that tree down that they've been decorating every year, instead of people, some little kid catching pneumonia outside from playing around the Christmas tree, and bring it indoors. So he was the one who basically brought the Christmas tree indoors for everybody to play with, indoors. You can blame him for that. He didn't leave Babylonian religion. He kept it all. He got rid of a lot of the stuff. He really showed through Scripture how that mass is an abomination before the Lord. And when you see this woman who has this cup of abominations, and here in her hand is a thing that is a substitute for what Jesus did on the cross, and you are making yourself righteous by doing this good work, by taking the Mass every time, and making God like you every time you do a Mass, and even after you're dead, you can pay for the priest to have a whole bunch of Masses done in your favor so that you don't have to stay in purgatory so long. And fact is, purgatory comes from Babylonian religion as well. It's not in the Bible. So is the Catholic Church Mystery Babylon? It's just a part of it. The same as the Greek Orthodox Church. We just don't know as much about it because that's not our heritage. It's just as bad. But how much of Babylonian religion is in our life? Even the celebration of Halloween is Babylonian religion. It's got all of its roots in the same place. I like the pretty lights. I like the Christmas music. I like all the pretty stuff. But it's not biblical. You don't need to confuse the two. And then there's that guy in a red suit. He looks more like the beast than anybody I know. He knows when you've been naughty, and he knows when you've been nice. He knows if you've been bad or good, so you better be good for goodness sake. It's all about work righteousness. You better be good, or you're not going to get nothing for Christmas. And what we have, this morph of Santa Claus that we've got, is little pieces, parts, from Babylonian religion that went into all of the tribes in Western Europe. And you've got Thor, and you've got Odin, and you've got, you know, basically the Santa Claus creature was a guy who was basically translated as Black Peter, who had a bag over his shoulder, and he'd take all the bad kids, and he'd throw them in that sack and take them down to hell. He was the one that went through, and you know, he was the one who went through the chimneys and took bad kids down to hell with him. That's the real Santa Claus. Really. But we've turned him into this thing. And he's right there in the nativity scene. So what is this nativity scene thing? When you got the two X's on the manger that hold the box that, you know, where Jesus was set, that's Thomas. It's like saying, look over here, it's Thomas, baby in the manger. And here is Madonna with her baby. Not the singer. It's a different pagan religion, but not too far off from that. If you look at all the pictures that show Mary with baby Jesus, why is it so important? Because this is the mystery religion. This is Semiramis and Tammuz. And they have unearthed ancient things. Ancient little, you know, sculptures made out of brass. And they look just like what we got today. They look the same. Because it is the same. Why do we celebrate Mary and the baby so much? Now, it's become an icon. So you see that, and everything that you believe, all of your biblical values, yes, you know that Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary. You know that. She was a virgin. That's God the Son being born in her womb. And you see that. And that's what you project into that icon. But they've unearthed things that are B.C. 1,000 years before Christ was born, and it looks just like the pictures and the sculptures of Mary and Jesus right now. And they projected into it something totally different than what we would project into that icon. But you have these icons, and you're going to project into them what you believe Is that what that means? That's what you believe it means. So that's all that matters. There's the idea of unity of all Christendom is really, really important. And what are we seeing today? We're seeing pressure being put on people who don't want to be unified. The people who are getting the most pressure are us fundamentalists. Do you mean you believe it? You're going to take the Bible literally? Like you're actually going to believe that the Holy Spirit inspired those words? Why do you think there's such an attack against the King James Version? Because they want to leave it open for any kind of version and perversion that happens to be out there. Because there is this organization that's trying to bring all world religions onto one unified group again. And they're getting more and more powerful. They meet about every 100 years or so. And they have determined to have one Bible that's going to be acceptable to every single world religion. And when I see how much emphasis is put on the Message paraphrase, and how many churches that used to be evangelical and solid now are quoting from this horrible thing, I wonder if that's the one they chose. When you can't even use any major Christian publisher and accept your book to be published without every verse of the Bible that you're using in your text to be changed to the Message paraphrase. And they won't even publish your book. You got to publish it privately in order to have it published without using the Message paraphrase in it. I think that's the paraphrase that they're choosing for the one Bible for all the world to agree on. The one that says, as above, so below in the Lord's Prayer. Same thing that witches pray. God of Green Hope. Oh yeah, there's a biggie. What is that? I mean, come on guys. Open up your eyes to the stupid stuff they've done to God's holy inspired word. What's the matter with you guys? I am angry and I want to kick the butt of every single pastor who talks about that thing, who says how great it is, how beautiful it is, and I'm ready to punch him out right in the face right now. And I don't care if they're willing to kill me or not. Really? Because they are bringing something that's demonic to their people and telling them that it's something good. Oh, what a neat way of saying that. Why do you have to introduce it every time by saying how great Eugene Peterson is? I'm sorry, Eugene Peterson, if he doesn't repent, he's going to go to hell. Because he doesn't believe in the resurrection. Why in the world would you take a paraphrase from a man who is not even going to go to heaven? What's the matter with you people? I'm sorry, this is stupid. This is stupid. Has everybody gone crazy? Yes. How have they gone crazy? They have been mesmerized by what? Mystery Babylon, the great, the mother of all harlots and abominations of the earth. Even evangelical pastors, the ones who used to spread the gospel and people used to get saved, have now come under the authority of this prostitute. And we already read over here, come out of her. If you don't come out of her, you're going to get all punishments that God's going to pour down on Babylon. Get out, get out, get out, while there's time. The one world religion uses, there's three different things. I'm going to give you some big words. One is called eclecticism. Eclectic, all kinds of things. Eclecticism, it's so neat. We can enjoy everybody's traditions. That's what we got at Christmas time. We've got everybody's traditions. We've morphed them into one. Eclecticism. This is a philosophy of religion which refuses to accept any one system of doctrine, but seeks to take all the so-called best from all systems of belief. Eclectics, at least, outwardly seek to be fair to all and therefore yield to all. Eclecticism. That's what we're seeing even in the evangelical community. Okay, the next one is latitudinarianism. That's a crazy word, latitudinarianism. This is a system of religion which cares little about creeds or doctrine. Isn't that what we're hearing from, you know, the emergent church? You know, you can't tell me that you can actually tell what the Bible says. Who can really understand it? That's what they're saying, even from the pulpit. They give you all these different things that you could probably believe in if you want to. That's latitudinarianism. This system, sincerely, is more important than what is believed. But as above, it opens the door for anything. And that's where we're at. Anything. And what they're doing is experience at all costs. Anything, as long as it's an experience. So you can go ahead and go into the silence, go to that place where Mystery Babylon lives out there in the wilderness, and you can go listen to whatever thing wants to talk at you. Or you can go and have some other world religions, demonic devices, and having all these experiences, and they say it's the Holy Spirit. No. You can go to the same church and they got yoga classes going on and you can get your chakras open. Oh boy, isn't that going to be swell? The moment that happens, besides the severe pain and the crazy stuff that goes on in your brain, you're going to open up to all kinds of demonic suggestions. Oh, it's just stretching. Yeah, you're tweaking your nerves by things that make your body do what it wasn't made to do, which is the same as if you were just going to be saying the Lecto Divina for 200 times till your brain shuts up. The next one is syncretism. We talked a little bit about this when we were going through some of the seven churches. This system seeks to unite all opposing theological and philosophical positions by arriving at a common denominator or by coming to a new synthesis. Okay, that's the whole idea of coming to consensus. That's TQM. And that's where they're going. I mean, if you just look at Saddleback right now and where they've come from, where they started, and how have they gotten there? And can anybody even get saved there? When you got, you know, Dr. Oz speaking from the pulpit, and you've got, you know, what in the world? That guy's not even a Christian, you know? What's the matter with these people? This guy's got nothing of value to tell me, because he's speaking from Satan himself, because is from Islam. What's the matter with these people? This is a great harlot. This is Mystery Babylon. And it's using everything it's got at its fingertips to get its work done. It loves TV. Because people sit there, the moment they get into TV, now the scientists are finally figuring out that it's actually causing brain damage, because you're not sitting there actively thinking, you're sitting there passively receiving. And as you passively receive, you're not thinking about anything except what this does. So it's actually causing your brain to stop working. It's like, how do you keep a kid occupied? Just put a TV in front of them and they're mesmerized. Yeah, of course they're mesmerized. They got this little bitty brain that hasn't been fully developed yet, and now you're going to tell that little brain to stop working and just absorb stuff. Of course, it's a great occupier. And they're not going to mess around. They're not going to get in trouble. They're just going, oh, look at the pretty colors. Look at the nice music. Oh, look at these people jumping around. They don't even know what they're watching, but they're mesmerized. Doesn't matter if you're little or you're big. Your brain's shutting off, and you're just absorbing whatever they tell you, and you've got no discernment. It's not even activated. You're just absorbing it all. And they'll use music, because music, it soothes the savage breast. I mean, it's going in, it feels so good, and you know what? Whatever words are going on with the music, you're just accepting it. And you don't even know you're accepting it. You know, I'm working in some of these buildings, they got music playing in some of these places because they're trying to get people who are about my age to buy stuff. They got that music from that age playing. And I go, wow, I heard that when I was in grade school. I heard that when I was in college. And you know what? I never listened to the words. I know the song. I probably have the words memorized, but I don't know what they mean. And now I'm hearing these words like, oh, wait a minute, I know the words of this. This is terrible. I can't believe that this lady would be saying it, or this guy would be saying that. And her, you know, like, I didn't know that that's what this meant. Because my brain was shut off, because it was just nice listening to music. Oh, I just like the music. I'm not listening to the words. Yeah, you're listening to the words. A spoonful of sugar makes the medicine go down. Now, how do I remember those words? Because it came from a song from watching a movie. Well, you don't want to eat that nasty medicine. No, put sugar in it. It'll taste so sweet. That's how it's seductive. Made her drunk with the wine of her fornication. Here is a cup. Drink it. And you're instantly drunk. And you just take on whatever they tell you. With no discernment whatsoever. You're just drunk. All of a sudden, wow, I feel so good. And I'm immediately changed. And now I'm getting these suggestions in my brain. And now I'm thinking about stuff that I never thought of before. And it's not right. And why do I have these thoughts? I mean, I know those aren't right. I know this is not right before God. Why are those thoughts in my head? You got those thoughts from the outside. And religion works the same way. Because if you did something as a kid in church, I guarantee by the time you're 40 and you would see that happen or watch it happen, it'll bring tears to your eyes. Is that a spiritual experience? No, it's a soulish experience. But it works every time. It's like, oh, I remember when I said that, when I stood up in church as a little kid, and I said, I remember when he did that song. I remember that. And so is it, what are you getting? We have to break free from every bit of Mystery Babylon. You know, we can say, okay, well, it's a Catholic church. Is it? It's in evangelical circles just as bad as a Catholic church. It's just a little bit different. I mean, you could have Christmas without having a Christmas tree. You can have Christmas without having a little decorative holly. You can have Christmas without having a wreath. You can have Christmas without a star on the top of the tree. I mean, all these things, it's all pagan. All paganism. We take that icon that we got as a little kid and we project into it our own biblical values. But it's Mystery Babylon. Now, Christianity spread. We just had Columbus Day. Wasn't that neat? Isn't that neat? Well, I didn't get it off. I don't know if you did either, but the mail didn't come. Anyway, somebody got it off. And what happened? Christopher Columbus came over. And what did he do? He claimed this new world for Christ, supposedly. And the spread of the gospel. And they had priests on those ships. And they spread Christianity. And they would see these guys and they're going to their little pagan altars. And you know what? What do those pagan altars look like? They're still there to this day. They're ziggurats. There's ziggurats, even in Central and South America. There's ziggurats there. You can go down and visit them. Machu Picchu, or whatever you call that place. There's a ziggurat up there. Babylonian religion from Nimrod and the Tower of Babel got spread over every inch of this planet as they were in rebellion against God and got spread over every part of this world. And you can find them. They're finding these hills now that have the same angle as pyramids. And now they're doing archaeology and finding they are stone steps of a ziggurat that's been covered over for thousands of years in Eastern Europe. And there's a bunch of little ziggurats that are there in Babylon that they're unearthing. And that's not the big one. Just little ones. Not to mention, we understand the Egyptian pyramids. We only see that as Egypt. No, that's... You know, when you have walls that go out and then come up, it's lesser weight. As you get to the top, you can get those things pretty, pretty high. It's pretty amazing. It's pretty amazing what happens. Well, Babylonian religion has spread all over this planet. It's still here. So when the Catholic Church came and started conquering territory, how did they do it? They did it by placing a Christian icon over a pagan icon. And those natives just continued to do the same thing. You ever see these little things? They got little candles burning? Why burn candles in front of an altar or in front of something? That's the same as Isis. That's the same as Semiramis. We're talking the sun versus Bel, which is the moon, Baal. Light the candle. It's worshiping Semiramis, however you want to say your name. That's why they have candles. That's all over the place. You go to Catholic ceremonies, everywhere you go, there's all kinds of candles every place. But why did these people in a whole different continent have little candles burning in front of some pagan altar? It's the same religion. There are idols of women with a child in South America that were there before Columbus got here. But they've got Mary names now because they have now called her, instead of Semiramis and Tammuz, now they're calling her Mary and Jesus. The same place, the same spiritual stronghold, the same pagan deity, only they put Mary's name on there. So what happens? People are worshiping Mary. Where in the Bible does anybody worship Mary? They've made her into something else. But see, because of Gnosticism, they had to make her into something else. Because you can't have someone who's 100% God and 100% man. It doesn't work. You can't have man who is basically evil, who is supposed to be a holy God. It can't work. Gnosticism says these things can't work. So just we have to somehow figure out how Jesus can be born and not have sin. So Mary has got to somehow be born sinless. So now you have the Immaculate Conception. So she's something completely different than a regular human being, so that she can have no sin, so that her baby won't have any sin. But is that how it happened? Did God have sex with Mary? No. No, God was formed in her womb. And if you look at the words that the angel said was going to happen to Mary, these aren't the Greek words and the Greek phrases that would be found in any kind of pagan imagery when any kind of deity would have sex with an earthly woman. These are completely different words. This is God being formed in her womb. He became a man in her womb. This is God in the flesh. This isn't half man and half God. But that's, you have to have a sinless Mary in order to have a sinless Jesus. But now even the evangelical community, you're going to hear, well, a sin gene is only passed through the man. And so, you know, that's why Jesus didn't have any sin, because God is his father and Mary is his mother. No. They've got it so confused because they are looking at it through the filter of Babylonian religion. Jesus is God in the flesh. He had to be our kinsman redeemer. He had to be our blood avenger. And that's what he is doing. And he is going to destroy this ugly pagan God. John saw it. And he was fighting against the Gnostics in his own day. And that angel who had a bowl of one of these plagues, one of these things that's going to pour judgment against the earth, against the Christ-rejecting people, he says, I got to tell you, John, let me show you what's going to happen to this pagan deity. This thing that's been dogging you, this thing that has blinded the eyes of those people who you were praying for, and they didn't get saved because they believed in some Babylonian religion and never came to faith. Let me tell you about the punishment that's going to come upon her, upon that world religion that takes its eyes away from Jesus Christ, God the Son. Let me tell you about the judgment against her. And then he gives them two whole chapters talking about it. So, I know I spent a lot of time on this, and we really didn't get very far beyond verse 6. But verse 6 says, "And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints, and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus, and when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration." Basically, it's when I saw her, I marveled with great marvelment. And then you're going to see that word marvel again in verse 7. I marveled. Just admiration is kind of weird in old English. It doesn't mean what it means today. But he was astounded. And he was marveling, and he just couldn't. It just, wow. The woman was drunken with who? The blood of the saints. And with the blood of the martyrs, that's those who had the testimony of Jesus. Those people who talked about Jesus to their friends and their family and everybody they knew. And she killed them. This world religion killed them. And it's time for the martyrs to be avenged. And that's what we'll read about in chapter 17 and 18. You ever see that book, Fox's Book of Martyrs? It's kind of scary and gross and gruesome. But when you read it, what you're going to find is the majority of the martyrs in there are people who died at the hands of the Roman Catholic Church. Because it's mystery Babylon the Great. It's Babylonian religion that overcame Christianity and Christendom. To the point where people can't tell the difference. And now Christians can't tell the difference because they don't know what's really Christian. And so what are the two biggest holidays even in the evangelical community? Christmas and Easter, which are Babylonian holidays. And all they know about Christianity is Christmas and Easter. Is Christmas and Easter in the Bible? No. Jesus gets born in the Bible? Yes. Is there ever a holiday about that? No. Did he get born on December 25th? Of course not. But we can figure out, because in Luke 2, in Luke 1, here is Zacharias, and he's of the order, he's a priest of the order of Abijah, which we know what month he served in. And he came home, and he impregnated his barren wife Elizabeth. They were very old. And Elizabeth was 6 months pregnant ahead of Mary. So we can figure out that the closest that Christmas can come to and the birth of Christ would be the time when Jesus was conceived in Mary's womb. That's the closest we can get. So the best possibility of looking at this, dealing with Abijah and so on, is that Jesus was born on the 29th of September, which would have been Rosh Hashanah. Feast of Tabernacles. I mean, Feast of Trumpets, rather. Feast of Trumpets. Could be. Really makes more sense, because every single feast of the Lord is going to be fulfilled by Jesus. The first ones have been, and there's some yet to come. And He's going to fulfill them too. Lord Jesus, we thank You for Your Word. Lord, there's just a lot of weird stuff that we talked about today, and a lot of stuff that is squirreling around in our brains, and we're confused, and we don't know what to think. Lord Jesus, bring us back to a knowledge of the truth, to love what the truth really is, to go back to Your Word. Lord, You give us feasts if we want to celebrate Him, and there they are, the appointed feasts of the Lord, and they don't come from the New Testament, they come from the Old Testament, but Lord, You give us things to celebrate in the new covenant. You give us baptism and You give us the Lord's Supper. And it's not the way the world religion looks at it. It's baptism isn't how to get saved, and the Lord's Supper isn't how to take away years from purgatory. These are things that celebrate what You have already accomplished for us once and for all. We thank You, Jesus, that You died on the cross for our sins. And we thank You, Lord, that You rose victorious from the grave 3 days later, and You rose from the dead on a Sunday, the festival of first fruits. You rose from the dead, and because You rose, we also will rise. You got a resurrected body, and we're going to get a resurrected body. We thank You, Lord, that You are victorious over death, victorious over the devil. We're reading about the time when You're going to prove Your victory as You destroy this Babylonian religion in front of the faces of all the people of humanity. And it's even going to happen at their hands, Lord. And You're going to avenge the blood of all those who were killed under her influence. We thank You, Lord Jesus, that You are victorious even over our own sin. And now whoever believes in You will not perish but have eternal life. Thank You, Lord Jesus, for Your Word. Lord, let us become lovers of the truth and follow the truth. Lord, we ask that You give us discernment. And we also, Lord, that You ask You to give us grace, dear God, as we deal with folks who still like all the pageantry, still like all the beauty, and still like all the pomp of the worldly Christianity. And Lord, give us grace to deal with them so that, Lord, if it's Your will, You could use us to lead them to a knowledge of the truth, dear God. Lord, take the devil's hands off their eyes, Lord, that blind them from the truth, and set them free. Bring them to a knowledge of the truth, Lord. Set them free, dear God. In Jesus' name, amen.